This is the Pulse of St. Louis.
Welcome to the Pulse of St. Louis. I'm Shirley Washington. You know, it's graduation season. Colleges and universities in the Gateway City area are hosting in-person and virtual commencement ceremonies due to the pandemic. Joining us now, Dr. Elizabeth Strobel. She is Chancellor of Webster University. Dr. Strobel, thank you so much for being here.
Oh, it's great to talk with you, Shirley, always. So thank you for inviting me.
Oh, absolutely. You know, we always have great conversations and I enjoy visiting with you. So this is a treat for me. So let's start the conversation talking about graduation. It's a big weekend for Webster University. Tell us what's going on.
Well, thank you so much. Our sheer numbers dictate that we need to be virtual for a second year. Over 4,000 graduates coming from around the world if we were in person. But of course, we will do it all through the magic of a virtual ceremony. And it is a wonderful moment always to celebrate achievement and success and promise and what we know will come in the future for these wonderful people that have chosen to spend their time and educational career at Webster. And of course, we have a keynote speaker, a commencement speaker that will inspire beyond measure. Jackie Joyner-Kersee, who will receive an honorary degree this weekend for her commencement, but of course, for an outstanding career, not only as a recognized athlete of the century, would not be an overstatement, as well as a humanitarian, a philanthropist, someone who makes her mark in the lives of young people each and every day, not only in our local community, but worldwide.
Absolutely. And then how did COVID impact graduation ceremonies at Webster last year?
So we were virtual last year as well. We think that we have improved our platform and our virtual capabilities in the 12 months that intervened. But, you know, it's not the same as hugging and shaking hands and hearing that grand music as we're together at the Muni. And we look forward to the day when that can all be possible and safe for us again.
Absolutely. Dr. Strobel, tell us about the kinds of challenges Webster University students faced, especially now. I mean, this is a big deal having graduation ceremonies to celebrate their accomplishments. But throughout the year during the pandemic, what kind of challenges did the students face?
You know, they talk, I think, almost to a person about what they've learned about personal resilience and how you face those challenges with courage and grace and persistence. Of course, most college students, particularly undergraduates, relish the college experience for what happens in the classroom, but also outside. They look forward to activities and social interaction in all the ways that college typically is about. So the challenges that they faced alongside with us was how to be safe and to do that anyway. So we have had a rich campus life, campus organizations, campus speakers, and we figured out how to do it in an online environment that in some cases made it work better. I will say the safety dimension has been first and foremost. And we chose because we believed in the strength of our community and how much they would care for each other, that we could do daily self-assessments, temperature checks, and we did not choose to test every one of us, employees or students during the year, but our confidence was rewarded and our students stayed amazingly safe and infection-free all year. So as we entered this spring, about 25% of our classes were happening, at least partially in person, and the rest either fully online or part in person and part online. And the most amazing part to me of the last month has been our athletic activity. We had to wait to start any kind of intercollegiate athletics until the NCAA gave us the green light. They did. But what that meant was that we have been playing every single sport that usually happens in distinct seasons at the same time. And the NCAA requirements require that those athletes and the officials and our own staff be tested to get a negative result every 3 days. That's thousands of tests that we have administered with good help of our partners. And we have had only across those thousands of tests, 3 positives, 1 official, and 2 of our students. And we're still in contention for championship play. So it is a testament to what our students are capable of when tested by the most extreme challenges. I am really proud of them.
And you should be. Now, how did Webster stay in touch with its global community? Because that's a big task, too.
It is. And in some ways, the digital environment made that more the norm. Our best example is our annual Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Conference. You and I have spoken about this conference before. We had never done it completely virtually before. We did this year, and we had 2,000 individuals register for the conference from all over the world. And we had presenters from all over the world. At one point, we had a panel discussion that included our own students talking about the challenges of COVID, of course, but also the issues of diversity and racial reckoning and what it's like to be part of a global community. We had students from Africa. We had students from Uzbekistan. We had students from all over the United States on the same panel. That would have been impossible to have achieved without a virtual environment. So in many ways, the virtual community was knit together in a stronger, more connected way because we didn't count on all being in the same room.
Yeah. And Dr. Strobel, you're absolutely right. We've had numerous conversations about the significance and the importance of diversity and inclusion. Let's talk a little bit more about that because I think that is a worthwhile conversation to have every day, all day, quite frankly. So let's talk about why is that so important?
I think that this Webster community, founded by women for women, always thought that we were a place to expand opportunity and equity and to be clear that we all need access to the same benefits and the same opportunities and the same challenges, and it cannot be restricted or limited to one population versus another. And our history has shown that we continue to expand to be true to that mission and to meet needs where they are. It's why we are so incredibly proud of our campus in Accra, Ghana. It was important for Webster, if we were truly global as a university, to have a location in a place that historically had, of course we know what the ties were across the African diaspora, but to have those ties take a modern day and contemporary reality where we start to build human bridges of people that are of African descent all over the globe, including young Africans who are growing up in what is the most youthful continent anywhere in the world. So it's building those human bridges to assure that worldwide, of course here in St. Louis, but everywhere, that human opportunity is optimized for the benefit of that individual, their families, their communities, and a better world.
Yeah, and Webster is also expanding educational opportunities to our military bases, correct?
Yes, indeed. We were pioneers in doing that in the 1970s. Of course, over the recent 12-month or 14-month period, access to those bases has necessarily been restricted. But we look forward to the day that that access opens up again and that all the service members, their dependents, and staff on the base can actually enroll in Webster courses, not only online, but in person. And we have done this with tremendous success. We are so incredibly proud that General Lloyd Austin, our current Secretary of Defense for this country, is a Webster grad. And he got his start right in Kansas, starting out a master's degree there, moved through the ranks, and no doubt used education as part of his leverage to establish his leadership. And we'll see it in evidence in this new and important role.
Absolutely. And then let's talk a little bit, Dr. Strobel, about Webster's efforts to help eliminate violence against women and girls. That's a huge issue, too.
Yes, it absolutely is. So we have been partners since 2017 in an NGO organization that's called the African Renaissance and Diaspora Network. This organization, based in Africa, but also New York City, is designed to empower youth, particularly across the diaspora, to care about the most fundamental human rights issues, as captured in the United Nations 17 Sustainable Development Goals. One of those goals is to bring equity and equality to gender for women. And they have a particular cause they're raising right now around what is, for short, SDG number 5, to end all violence and discrimination against girls and women in all its forms. Webster is a strong partner in this effort. And the way we partner is by highlighting conferences, readings, presentations, our own advocacy activities at every one of the Webster campuses, all the way from Uzbekistan to China, to Africa, to Europe and in the United States, to say, what does it mean to show violence and discrimination against girls and women? How is this expressed in your city, in your culture, in your country, and what measures can we take to stop it? Because the treatment that limits the opportunity for girls to get an education, to have healthy lifestyles, to be economically independent, hurts all of us, men and women alike.
And you're absolutely right. Dr. Elizabeth Strobel, Chancellor of Webster University, thank you so much for your time and thank you for your efforts and community. We appreciate you.
Thank you so much for giving us a voice, Shirley. You truly do keep the pulse of St. Louis.
Thank you so much. And straight ahead on the pulse, making plans for summer camp? Well, there are options available for St. Louis area kids. Stay with us. We are back in a moment.